So, buongiorno a tutti. Good morning. I'd like to start by thanking the organizers, Julia, Roberto, Giovanni, and all the staff for this wonderful setting. I really take a lot of pleasure to be here, and I'm sure you do as well. And I hope there will be some subsequent meeting similar to this. So today I will be talking about personalized growth modeling of brain tumors. So this is a joint work with many people, that including PhD students and colleagues, and also medical collaborators. And I will start by a general introduction, probably that will take like 15 minutes, on biophysical modeling and medical imaging. So we are now living in a digital world, and this means that both the data acquired on patients could be obviously medical images, but also biosignals, and all the medical recording of patients are now available in the digital format. And this incredible amount of data, which is specific to a given patient, can now be processed by computational models and tools. And those models can be of different nature. You have seen different examples during this week. They can be based on geometrical principle, physical, physiological principle. They can be also in an orthogonal dimension. They can be also processed with statistical principles. So I'm personally very much interested into analyzing medical images based on physiological models, or biophysical models, that are being actually coupled with images, and in the overall goal of creating personalized medicine, we are personalizing those models based on those images. So those models can be either personalized on a specific patient, they can be generic to represent an average member of a population, and in an orthogonal direction, there is a statistical analysis of the models, of the parameters of a model, if you want, that also act as, again, orthogonal information. So the application of this, what I call digital patient, is numerous. I'll start by computer diagnosis, which relies mostly on image segmentation and like machine learning. Also, at also low level, you've got image fusion. And what will be maybe of more interest for my lecture is the applications towards therapy simulation, for instance, for training medical residents, or therapy planning, or even therapy guidance. So therapy planning is more like you plan the strategy of the therapy, while the guidance is more to the tactics of a therapy, so just to guide the gesture of a physician. So these are the different applications of the digital patient. Now, when you are coupling, here on the right-hand side, you can see the tumor growth model. And the left-hand side, you've got the patient data, which are MR images where you can see the outline of a tumor. So when you try to match the simulation with the observations, which are in this type two time points, you can say, okay, what are the cause of discrepancies between my simulation and my observations? So maybe you can help me. What, do you have any clues why you would get some match or not so good match? Especially, what are the source of errors between your simulation and your data? Do you have any clue? Okay, I will help you. Maybe the parameters of a model are not so correct, and therefore, when you try to simulate, you don't get the proper predicted extent of a tumor. So what's one aspect of a source of errors? Can you find some others? Yeah? Sorry? Exactly, so that's good. So it's actually, the model is based on a hypothesis that you make, And those hypotheses may be playing wrong. So this is what I call a model error. That's one thing, indeed. Some other source of errors. Okay, so if you program as I program, you know, from time to time you don't exactly do the right thing, and this is called a bug. And usually it doesn't come into as a single, as a singleton. It comes with in pairs or family of bugs. So this is obviously one source of error. So you may actually have the right model, but you just made an error in implementation. Okay, another. So I will switch to the slide where I list the different sources of errors. So the first source of errors is actually your observations. Your observation may be indeed noisy, and I've got some artifacts. So maybe your model is actually perfect, but it doesn't match exactly because the observations are noisy. So that's one source of errors, which is not coming from the model, but from the observations. So this is actually the cause is related to the problem of acquisition and signal processing. So we already mentioned the last item, which is this modeling issue, okay? The errors of the model. But there are also errors of implementation. There's also another type is the error of discretization. So when you do your computation, usually you rely on a mesh or a grid, and you may have what we call discretization error, is that your equations are based on a continuous world, and you discretize them, and this may entail some errors. There are also the computational mesh, maybe a source of errors. This is irrelevant of its size, but it could be like the quality of a mesh may be wrong, or the boundary are wrong, if your segmentation is wrong. And then I mentioned already the parameters, which are includes also the initial conditions and the boundary conditions. So we can actually factor the source of errors into errors due to the observations. This is the first item here. Errors due to the what I call verification. So that's very important. So if you've got a model which is written by a set of equations and you want to implement them, you need to verify that what you get at the end of your simulation is what you expect. So this is called the verification, and this allows to actually handle both implementation and discretization errors. And then there is this what I call personalization issues, which is to find the right parameters, initial condition and boundary conditions. And finally, you've got the errors due to the model, which is wrong. So why would you like to personalize your model? So a first reason I think is a key is the fact that you want to understand what you observe in the images. So it's like knowledge building. So if your model, so you make a hypothesis, and if your model match what you observe, so you can say it doesn't mean exactly that your model is correct, but at least that you've got some agreement. So maybe you should test it for prediction. Because here, the advantage of using biophysical models is the predictive power. And if you've got errors, actually, you learn a lot by having errors between your model and your observations. And I'm very disappointed that you cannot publish papers that are only based on errors of models. Because in fact, this would be fantastic for the community to learn a lot from the hypothesis. And maybe this will come later, but I doubt that you get your MIKAI paper accepted by showing some models that fails, unfortunately. So, so the second objective of your model is not only to understand, but also to predict. And this is important for therapy planning. And finally, you may be interested into the parameters that you personalize, and this could be used for diagnosis. Okay, now just another general statement about how to couple models and images. So this is what you see here on this slide. On the left-hand side, you've got medical images, and on the right-hand side, you've got this tumor growth model. So there are, in general, two ways of coupling these two. And the first one is called data regularization. And in data regularization, I've got this balance here. And you mostly trust the data. And the data regularization, you should think of the filter such that the outcome of your analysis becomes physiologically plausible. So I will just make an example here. If you have your biophysical models, which is a dynamic system which depends on time and some set of parameters. Then to make your model fit to the data, you add some what I call image force, which basically drives the models towards the visible boundary in the image. Okay? So this is typically, this means that your biophysical model will be used as a prior for your analysis of your data. Okay? So it's called data regularization. So this is typically done in, for instance, when you are doing motion tracking with a cardiac model, you are regularizing the analysis of a vector field given by the optical flow, for instance, using some kind of a prior about the cardiac motion. So this data regularization do not lead to a predictive model. So the other side, where you mostly trust your model, is called model personalization, but it's also called data assimilation. So this is maybe a word that you haven't heard before. So this is a popular word in some other field of physics. And so the idea instead is that you want to fit, to find the parameters of an optimal set of parameters, theta star, such that, sorry, I should have removed the force, image force here, such that your the dynamic model your agrees with the data. So you can see it's a complete change of perspectives. In one case, you add some, I would say, iconic perturbation, which has no biophysical meaning. In other case, you want to optimize the parameters and the boundary conditions such that it agrees with the data. And this leads to predictive models. Okay. Some also issues that are common with the personalization of models. There are a number of ones, but I will not cover them into details. The first one is the observability of the parameters. And I'd like to make a very simple example to, I would say, carry on this concept here. I will take this example, the basic physical examples, where you've got a spring attached to the roof, and then you add a mass at the tip of the spring. And so what you want to estimate in this case is the stiffness of the spring. So the stiffness of a spring is, you need to know the elongation from the rest configuration, dx, and you need to know the applied force, which is, in this case, sufficient to know the mass of the object. So if you know the mass of the object and the elongation, you can know the stiffness of a parameter, of the spring, sorry, which is the parameter you want to observe. Now, if I take two springs that are in series like that, and then I add the same load, knowing the same thing, the overall elongation and the applied force, the only thing you can estimate is the sum of the two stiffness of the springs. And even a more, I would say, realistic situation is when you have two springs in series. Okay, so you've got two springs with stiffness K1 and K2. If you attach a bar to the two springs, and then you observe how the bar tilts. And knowing the angle of a tilt provides you information about the ratio of the two, stiffness, K1 over K2. So this is a typical example that occurs in medical imaging, because you are observing mostly in images what we call extensive variables in physics, okay, like volume, length, deformations. And if you only know extensive parameters, you cannot recover what we call the physical parameters, because those are usually a ratio between intensive variables and extensive variables. So if you are only using medical imaging, usually you can only estimate a ratio of parameters. So you cannot, the bottom line is that you cannot estimate and observe all the effect of all parameters. So you, that's something you need to know, and it's useless to try to achieve more, try to understand, sorry, to estimate single parameters if it cannot be observed. So finally, some general considerations that I always consider a model, a biophysical model, as a tool. And so for me, the models should always be designed to answer a given question. So this may not be the point of view for some researchers working some more maybe fundamental domain, but for me, I see a model as a tool, and such that it tries to answer some given questions. And I have always in mind the objective of finding the simplest model that can explain a given phenomena. So this is similar to what occurs in machine learning, where you have this principle of, you know, also called the parsimony, also called the Occam's razor. And while you're trying to find it's called sparsity, the principles, while you try to always to find the simplest model to explain a given phenomena, because you think that this will lead to more robust predictions. And I'd like to quote some sentence from the group of Dennis Noble in Oxford. Well, he stated that the ideal model will be as simple as possible and as complex as necessary for the particular question raised. And that's really in the set of mind I am doing my research. Some thoughts about this selection of models. So you have to realize that a model always fails somewhat. What is interesting is to be able, this is sad, but actually this is life. So it's better to take that into consideration and to be able to estimate the uncertainty of your model. So not only to focus on the prediction of your model, but also the associated uncertainty. And this requires that you try to estimate all the source of errors that is possible. I have listed basically the whole group of source of errors, but then you need to refine this for the particular problems at hand. And now, how can I validate a model? How do I know when it works? Well, basically, as I said, it never really works, but you can actually realize when it completely fails. And for instance, if you have, first of all, if your model doesn't agree with your observation at all, then it's no good, sorry, you have to try again, make different hypotheses. And this is how you actually, the understanding, this is basically the basis of scientific procedure, is that always to confront your hypothesis with the observations. And in this respect, some people claim that simulation, computer simulation, it can be considered as the third pillar of science, together with observations and the theory. So there's another situation where you should have doubt about your models is when you have a set of subjects that looks similar. For instance, you take healthy subjects that have a similar age and similar conditions, and when you try to personalize your model on those subjects, you would expect that the parameters are actually pretty similar to each other. And if that is not the case, then you should start to wonder about the quality of your model. So there is an example that we should follow, which is now probably 40 years old, is the weather forecast as a good example. So this is an example of a weather forecast in France. So I'm coming from the French Riviera, so I don't look at usually at the weather forecast because I know it's going to be sunny. But from time to time, I look at TV, and this is what I can see. And you have to observe, for instance, that when they make predictions for the whole week, they always include confidence in the weather forecast. And actually, the science of weather forecast, meteorology, has been the pioneer in data simulation. And so I think there's a lot to learn from those fields. So I would like to, in the future, maybe 10 years from now, that we have we replace this weather forecast with this biophysical forecast for a given patient and with similar accuracy. Okay, that was my introduction, general introduction about biophysical modeling. Now I will focus not on liver, but on the brain tumors. And especially some kind of brain tumors, they are called gliomas. Gliomas, I don't know exactly proper English. So these are actually the main brain tumors. 80% of the brain tumors are gliomas. And the incidence is about 5 to 6 cases per 1,000 person per year. Okay, so this is not a massive type of tumor, but for young adults, it's considered to be the third cause of death. And for child, it's considered also to be the second cause of cancer after leukemia. And the occurrence of gliomas is a maximum for persons that are between 50 and 60 years old. So most of you are safe, hopefully. And the diagnostic of gliomas are basically based on MRI and clinical symptoms. So I would say, going more into the details about this terrible disease, I will start by differentiating between low grade and high grade. So you can see at the bottom here, this line, well, you've got the different stage of a tumor. So it starts by being occult, means that you cannot observe it. And then it has a face, it's called grade 2, and then it's a face where it's silent. It means that you can see it on MR images, but it has no, it's asymptomatic, no clinical symptom, okay? And then it's still in grade 2, it becomes symptomatic. So the symptom can be very difficult to relate to this disease, can be neurological disorders, or it can be a seizure. And then at some point, so for some lesions, fortunately not for all of them, for a few of them, they will become what we call malignant. And then they will start to grow much faster. And then they enter what we call high-grade glioma, which are grade 2, grade 3, sorry, and grade 4. And unfortunately, for many of high-grade glioma, this would lead to death. So the low-grade glioma could be like astrocytoma, oligodendroglioma, and the median survival is 10 years. But actually, the population, there's a large number of populations which completely survive them, and a fraction of them which unfortunately die fairly, I would say, quickly. For the high-grade glioma, the main high-grade glioma is called glioblastoma. And the median survival in this case is much much more terrible, unfortunately. It's considered to be 16 months of survival after the discovery of the disease, okay? And this graph here on the right-hand side, you may see that this is the survival after 2 years, and compare from the 50s to 2000. So in 40 years, unfortunately, the survival rate has not improved much. And this is actually, unfortunately, so there has been most of the research now and for improving the care has focused not on survival but on quality of life, which is considered to be a better index of success. Okay, now how do we observe this tumor disease? So we use MR images. And I'm talking now about low-grade gliomas. And you observe a tumor first by looking at the T2 of the flare. This is one of the MR sequence. And you can see some hypersignals appearing in the flare imaging. And some slightly hyposignal occurring on T1 and T1 with gadolinium. Gadolinium is a contrast agent which reveals regions that are highly perfused. And these low-grade glioma are based mostly on using T2 or flare. So for high-grade gliomas, this is a bit more complex because you are not only looking at the hyperintensity in flare, but also in the T1 with gadolinium that you can see here, you can look at the green region. This is called the necrotic core. This is a region that has where all the cells have developed and that died naturally due to apoptosis, the lack of oxygen. Okay, so this appears in dark. So this is in T1 plus gadolinium here. Now, the active rim, the active the region where you've got all these proliferating cells, they appear here in orange, and they are like creating a crown surrounding the necrotic core. And then you've got what we call the edema. So what is edema? In fact, we don't really know what is edema, but edema is, in general, is considered like inflammatory regions. And it's usually a region where you've got a few isolated tumor cells, but also inflammation. Well, there's a breakdown of the extracellular matrix, and you've got water that flows in these regions. And as I said, we don't quite know. I mean, we know it's not a homogeneous region, so there are like vasogenic edema or infiltrated edema, and there's still a lot of research trying to understand what is there. So, in fact, understanding the imaging of glioma is probably, for me, the greater challenge, because we don't actually know what we observe. So let me give you an example here. So this is a T2 flare image of with a large tumor here. And this is a study done in Paris. Well, they have taken biopsies at a different locations. So biopsies outside the visible boundary of a tumor and inside. So you see P1, P2 are biopsies taken outside, and P3, P4, P5 are inside. So if they take biopsies and then they analyze. And then what you see is that in the regions that are outside, like in these regions here, you can see that you still have tumor cells that are present. So it means that although you may think that the tumor is only in this region, okay, in fact the tumor extends beyond the visible boundaries. Okay, so it's not as simple as that. So what you see is not related to the tumor cell concentration. It's related to something else. Okay, so again, the fact is all the therapy is usually based on the visible boundary. And unfortunately, we know that there are also tumor cells that do not appear in these regions, but they are somewhere else in the brain. And so, so the main hypothesis that is being done, so in this graph here, you have a tumor cell density, and as a function of a distance, so we take a cross-section across this tumor, so you can see some histological view. So the very, very basic hypothesis we make is that this T1 plus gadolinium, the active rim, corresponds to a given threshold of a tumor cell density. And the edema corresponds to a lower threshold of tumor cell density. Okay? So if I slice, so this red contours here that appears in T1 plus gadolinium corresponds to an ISO value of tumor cell density, which is high, and this over threshold, over contour visible in T2 or flare correspond to a lower threshold. This is the hypothesis that most of us make. And the sad thing is that we know it's wrong. And there has been some recent study, again based on biopsies, that showing that in fact the visible boundary may be more related to the amount of edema, so amount of water, if you want, in this extracellular matrix, rather than the change of tumor cell density. Okay, but this was done only on 9 patients, so this is not a well-established, I would say, statement, but and this is, I would say, one of the main issues in tumor brain imaging, understanding what we observe. So what are the possible treatments of gliomas? Fortunately, there are quite a few. So the first treatment is, in fact, to do nothing. This may sound surprising, but you have to know that there are a huge number of proportion of subjects that have small glial tumors, okay, that will never that will almost never grow during life, and they can live a perfect life with a small glial tumors, which never becomes malignant. Okay. In fact, this study, which I found, said that there's the ratio of subjects having small glial tumors is about 3 to 6 per 1,000 people. Okay. Remember that the prevalence of gliomas is 5 to 6 per 1,000 people. So there are like 1,000, there's a huge proportion of subjects that have small glial tumors that will almost stay in grade 2, that will almost never grow or grow extremely slowly, and that the brain, actually, the plasticity of the brain is such that it will compensate for any possible damage and it will stay always asymptomatic. So you may discover glial tumors. In fact, I made the computation this morning, and this means that there is, in average, statistically, one person in this assembly that has a glial tumor that is asymptomatic, okay, in average. And I think in the US, it means that there are 1 million people having asymptomatic gliomas. It's a huge number, okay? So, and when you discover by chance glial tumors, and that are very small, You become maybe somebody at risk, but there is a huge possibility that nothing is being done. And when there is more suspicious of a malignant tumor, then the surgery is being performed. And okay, the surgery consists in removing the visible boundary of the tumor in the brain. So there's obviously some difficulty to that. For instance, you don't want to impact some important functional areas of the brain. And now there's a new technique which is called awake surgery, where the patient is awake and the surgery takes place while the patient is awake. And they always test the functional areas before removing some part of a tumor. And in fact, this new technique leads to the removal of a greater extent of a tumor, which may seem a bit of a paradox. So you can remove more tumor and at the same time keep a high quality of life for the patients, because then you test that you are damaging or not the functional area. So and surgery is definitely the I would say a mandatory treatment. And so there is usually a period where you watch, and then when you are sure that you've got a malignant tumor, you perform surgery right away. And there is also radiotherapy. Radiotherapy, so you are sending ionizing, ionizing waves to the patient. Ionizing particles to the patient. And so you use the visible boundary of a tumor in the image, and then you add some 2 centimeter margin around it. That's the standard therapy. I will come back to this later on, showing how we can improve this. And there is also chemotherapy. So chemotherapy is not the, a main therapeutical treatment here. The reason is that there is the brain-blood barrier, you know, that's this barrier that blocks the effect of drugs on the brain. However, the tumor tends to break this brain-blood barrier, and therefore you still have some effect of the drugs. So this is the effect of anti-angiogenic drugs that can also help, like Avastin, during the treatment. And usually it's a combination of those three. You start by surgery, then radiotherapy, then chemotherapy. Okay, now this is the main picture for the gliomas. We have looked at how it appears in images, the prevalence, how we can treat them. Now, in the remainder of my talk, I will be concerned with three main problems. The first one is to quantify the extent of a tumor. And we will see how this is done in clinical ways and how we can improve this. The second is how to quantify the tumor evolution, and this is where we will introduce tumor growth models. And finally, how we can improve the clinical practice using those tumor growth models. So I will start with the first one. I will be short on that, because I know Antonio will talk about this afternoon, and this is more related to image segmentation that was covered during the first few days of a summer school. Okay, so the clinical practice, I think Mike Brady really emphasized this clearly, that to measure the extent of a tumor, this is performed by looking at the MR image, especially the T2 and FLAIR image, and then to measure the longest diameter in the actual slice. And the new regulations is called the Reynaud-McDonald, considers also some orthogonal diameter in the same slice. And finally, they do not consider differentiate between the tumor compartments, like the edema, the necrotic core, and so on. So this is extremely, you can consider this as extremely basic, but this is the basis for all the clinical treatment of brain tumor currently. So I was talking about compartments. So you could, in fact, differentiate in terms of segmentation. This is inspired by the Bratz challenge. You could differentiate between healthy tissue and the tumor, so tumor here being tumor and edema. And then in this tumor and edema, you could differentiate the core and the edema. Like here, you've got the edema here, that is visible in this FLAIR image, and then your core, which is here. And within the core, you can differentiate between the enhancing core, the one that is being enhanced by the gadolinium in T1, and the non-enhancing core. And then you've got the necrotic core and the rest. Okay. So it's actually, as we will see, segmenting tumor in medical images is extremely difficult. And there is a growing attempt to automate this. And this graph here shows the number of papers in PubMed about automatic brain segmentation. This, I took that from the paper from the BRADS challenge. So you got these green curves, it's showing the number of papers about automated brain segmentation, tumor brain segmentations, as opposed to the papers on about regular measurements of brain tumors. So this is picking up, it's only like 10 years old, problematic. And I'd like to emphasize that a big driver for improving these methods is the using the existence of a challenge, in a Mikhail challenge. It's called the BRATS. I forgot what it means, but it's probably a brain whatever. And this has been organized for the past from the 2012 by Björn Menzer, who is now a professor at University of Munich, Mauricio Reyes, who is a professor in Bern, and some collaborators in Boston and MGH and NIH. And this has been a major driver for, I would say, that the community gets organized about what we should segment and what is the ground truth, and to really foster the availability of open database. And so I'd like to just make publicity about this paper that appeared in TMI recently. So this is one of the few papers where the first page is only dedicated to the naming the authors and their affiliations. So there are more than 50 authors, and actually I had to call INRIA to allow more than 50 co-authors of a paper because the system was blocked at 50. So, but this is really the cooperative work for this challenge. And again, I'd like to praise their initiative. So as I said, this is very difficult to segment. So on the right-hand side, you've got different segmentation of the same tumor performed by several experts. In this case, that was clinicians, in fact, not PhD students, but clinicians. And you can see in magenta the consensus rate. So you can, I just gave a random example on the BRADS challenge and the figures that we provide. So you can see the discrepancies between the different raters, okay, and the boundary. And some you can see are fairly surprising. And this, I don't think this is a very difficult one. So the average die score between raters is in average around 90 for the whole tumor, but it decreased, for instance, for the active rim, it decreased to 80% of agreements between the raters. That's not very high. And so this just shows how much, how difficult it is to segment those images. And in fact, we cannot call these magenta lines like a ground truth. And I think I would advocate in this case to use more like a probabilistic ground truth than a single ground truth. So if you want to know more about segmentation of tumor brain tumors, you can have you can read those two surveys, one in July 2013. And by the group of Mauricio Reyes in Bern, and one from Elsa Angelini that appeared in 2007. And you can distinguish, actually, in terms of methods, between generative models. So generative models are models where you try to explain the image from the knowledge of different compartments. So if you have a tissue which is labeled as necrotic, you have a probability that this tissue is necrotic, you create a model on how this should translate into the image, final image. And then to solve the segmentation problem, you solve an inverse problem. Since you have an image, you want to get back to the probability of having the labels. So these are generative models that are usually put into a Bayesian framework, and that has some interesting characteristics. And the other types of models are discriminative, typically based on machine learning. And I'd like to just show some example that was performed in our group together with Antonio. I'm sure that Antonio will talk more about that this afternoon. But so we are using the random forest in this case. So these are binary trees, a set of binary trees. Well, you perform at the same time classification and feature selection. So in terms of features, we used the multi-channel information, so the intensity of the pixels in the different MRI sequence. T1, T2, flare, T1 plus gadolinium. You use also some information about white matter or gray matter, and some contextual features like the symmetric parts of the image. So indeed, usually the tumor occurs in one side of the brain, and so if there is a difference between the symmetric parts of a tumor with respect to the mid-sagittal plane, you could say there's probably a tumor there if it breaks the symmetry. And another type of contextual features are this difference of blocks, average of intensity in those different blocks here. So the nice things with, I would say, random forest is that you can analyze the outcome of a feature selection. And it was found that 41% of the features used were contextual features, where you make difference of intensity in those blocks. 36% was based on asymmetry, and only 23% was based on intensity, local intensity. So this provides some interesting hints about how to visually capture the tumor in the image. And these are some typical examples that was actually obtained by Ezekiel Jeremia in his thesis. Well, you can see the ground truth here and the random forest at the bottom. And so this was evaluated through the BRATS challenge in 2012, 2013. And this year they had they will have a challenge as well. And they have this nice infrastructure for evaluating the outcome of a segmentation. And this year they will actually perform segmentation on a very large, like 200 type of images, I think. Okay, so this shortly covers the issue of segmenting the brain tumors in the images. Now we will move to the meat of the talk, which is more about the quantification of a tumor evolution. So right now, the way it is performed is, again, using the in clinical practice, is using those one-dimensional measurements of a tumor extent using this RECIST criteria, and they look at how much this diameter change over time. And if the diameter is greater than 20% in the T1 plus gadolinium and also in T2 flare, then they consider that you have changed the staging, for instance, of a tumor. And then you become more like a malignant tumor, and then you should start radiotherapy, surgery, and so on. So there's a lot of important decisions being made based on those indices. And so there is the RANO criteria, which is like from 2010, I think, which not only consider the largest diameter, but also the second largest diameter, orthogonal to the first one. So we have made a recent, I would say, exercise, which is we took, like in this case, three patients where we have a visible tumor in the image. And then we used three criteria to measure the speed of growth. The first criteria was to use the largest diameter, like in the RECIST. The second criteria was to use the second largest diameter. So you've got an area, you take the product of the two, you get an area. And to estimate the speed, you take the square root of this. So this is actually this formula here. And then you can also do the 3D segmentation. So in this case, you slice by slice, you do the segmentation using one of those algorithms that I mentioned before. So you get another estimation of speed, which is V3D. So this example shows how the different speed of growth can vary using three, I think, meaningful ways of measuring growth, right? You measure how the largest diameter change, or the second largest, or the whole volume. So these are three sensible ways of measuring tumor growth, but then you get some pretty important discrepancies of measuring the. So this is again of the same patient, but three different ways of measuring tumor growth. And you can see you've got some discrepancies, and this is not necessary that the blue curve is always the largest speed. It can be the reverse. So this is showing that here we are not these decisions are not based on very grounded principles. But just by changing the way you measure growth, you can get some fairly large discrepancies. So it's difficult here. So they make a threshold on 20% growth, but you can easily understand that this may not be, a solid process to decide of a progression. The progression of a disease. So. Can we do better? So we hope so. And this is why we started to develop personalized tumor growth models. And one of the main applications, the first application we had in mind, was to propose some more, I would say, physically grounded ways of measuring tumor progression. Instead of relying on a single diameter or even the volume, we think that we could have a better, produce more sensible ways of measuring how tumor grow. And another thing is that our evaluation of a tumor growth takes into account also the what we call anatomical barriers, because the tumor cannot grow into the CSF. You know, CSF is the cerebral spinal fluid, and so this creates normal barriers where the tumor cannot grow. And this is very important to take that into account in order to assess the speed of the tumor growth. And also, and this is maybe more, I would say, provocative or disputable, we would like to use these models also to predict the future extent of a tumor in the future. So tumor growth modeling. So this, I will, maybe you should, I would say, I would like to refer to Mike's presentation on Monday, when I think he has conveyed the idea that modeling the phenomena of tumor growth is extremely difficult, complex, but also is we don't have a full understanding by far of the different phenomena involved. Just to give you some ideas, so they are considered usually like three types of growth. We have avascular growth, there's the phenomenon of angiogenesis, and then the vascular growth. So usually the vascular growth occurs in the later stage of the disease. And so this phenomena occurs at different scales, and so at the protein scales, for instance, for the VEGF, which is used for angiogenesis, but also at the microscopic scales, taking into account the barriers, for instance, here, the brain ventricles. So the message here, it's extremely, is we have to be very humble here when we start to try to model the tumor growth. And however, there has been a community that has been growing since the last 15 years that tried to create mathematical models of how tumor grows. And the first type of models are microscopic. So they look at like a petri dish and how the tumor grows in vitro. And with in vitro experiments, and then they look at the very fine details of the mechanism of tumor growth. And so this leads usually to sometimes very complex ordinary differential equations that can be also stochastic, so using Markov models for transitions between the different types of phenotypes. And usually those models are used for understanding, but they are not personalized. I don't know of microscopic models that has been personalized on observables of tumor growth in vitro, for instance, at this stage, at this level. So in opposition, there has been, so these models, I think, they are the most, the oldest model that has been developed. And now they are more like the microscopic models, with a number of actually researchers that belongs to more of a community of medical image analysis, because they are using the observations available in the images, and then they are only interested in the, some kind of average behavior of a tumor. They are not looking at very precise details on how the tumor transforms itself. And this leads to, as you will see, fairly simplified model, extremely simplified for to say the truth, but however, those models can be personalized, and this is the whole objective here, is to not only develop a model for the sake of understanding the phenomena, but also in order to provide a tool for improving clinical practice. So the approach I will describe today belongs to this family of microscopic models. And maybe if you are interested in this topic, you should consider looking at this book here that appeared in, I think it's probably 2010, yes. It's called Multiscale Cancer Modeling, which approach both aspects of microscopic models and macroscopic models. So I'd like to make a very introduction to very basic tumor growth models. And actually, those models are not specific for tumor growth, but they are also used in biology, even for analysis of the population of animals, for instance. So these are growth, global growth models. So the simplest growth models that I can think of is exponential growth models. So on the left-hand side, you've got the example of tumor cell density that evolve over time as an exponential, okay? And the speed of growth is given also by an exponential function. It's not an exponential function, it's a straight line. This is an exponential tumor growth model, but this exponential tumor growth model makes the assumption that you've got an infinite amount of resources which is being available in order to grow indefinitely the tumor growth, which is definitely not true. You've got a finite amount of resources. This is called a carrying capacity in biology. So you've got this limited carrying capacity, meaning that you don't the amount of glucose, for instance, you can provide to the tumor is limited by the amount of food you eat every day. So that's why this logistic growth was proposed like in 19th century, which makes the hypothesis that you have a limit carrying capacity and means that the tumor cell density starts from zero, grows, and then reach a plateau. And which is the value of one in this case, okay? And then the speed of growth is given by this bell curve. So once you reach the half of the carrying capacity, the speed of growth then start to decrease and finally reach zero when you have used all the available nutrients. Okay, that's the idea of this logistic growth. And actually in the model that we are proposing, we are using this logistic growth. It's a very simplistic model, but it's the one that carries the fact that you have a limited amount of, again, nutrients available. And then, actually, in the 1970s, you had the first success of fitting measured growth. So you could measure the volume of a tumor from a patient over time. And they had so this plot of points, and they showed that the Gompertz law was able to fit this tumor growth volume better than the exponential of the logistic laws. So the advantage of the Gompertz law, you've got the differential equations here, is that you've got a different speed for growth and a different speed for, I would say, the asymptotic parts. So you can see you have got a very high speed accelerations, if you want, at the beginning and a slow one at the end. So this corresponds better to what has been observed for tumor growth in, over time. And then there is this generalized logistic law, which actually, you introduce this parameter nu. And if you take nu equal to one, you get the regular logistic growth. And if you take nu closer to zero, you get the Gompertz law. So this is like a more general approach. And then you've got actually some even more general growth laws than this one, but I also wanted to mention this approach, which is called universal growth. So in 2001, there was a paper that appeared in Nature, and stating that the growth of animals and organs, they all follow the same law, independently of the time of lifespan and the scale. And this law actually includes this exponent, 3/4 and 1/4. And so this is claimed to be like the universal law of growth for any biological systems. Obviously, this is a very controversial model, but it has been also used for tumor growth. But you can see it's always the same type speed growth. You can see this initial growth, which is which raise very fast, and then which start to decrease and to reach zero after some time. Okay, so those global models of growth are very simplistic, and these are ordinary differential equations, and they only are interested into the, how the overall volume of a tumor evolves over time. So the fact is that this model do not take into account the heterogeneity of the image, the fact that you've got a necrotic core, you've got the edema, and so on. It doesn't take also into account some anisotropy in the phenomena and some natural barriers. So the objective in the 1990s was actually to switch from global tumor growth into local ones. So we went from global to local models. And in terms of mathematics, if you want to do this, there are two main approaches to do this. The first one is to transform your you transform your ordering differential equation into a partial differential equations. And one classical aspect, classical approach to do that is to use advection or transport phenomena. So in a transport phenomena, you've got this. You define a velocity field in your domain, and then you just say that your let's say outline of a tumor. Which is shown here in black, is following the velocity field. Okay, you are flowing on this velocity field. And then you, for instance, given this velocity field, you obtain the yellow lines. And so some authors have chosen to use this approach of advection, or actually level sets, if you want to translate that into something that you know if you are familiar with image segmentations. So they use this advection formula to describe tumor growth. However, most of the approach being used are not based on advection, but are based on diffusion. So you've got your reaction term here, which is the same as before, but then you add a diffusion term. And why is that they use a diffusion term? It's because the physiological phenomena of tumor growth is indeed, we know that there are some migration of tumor cells, which is due to some phenomena of diffusion. And in fact, this is especially true for brain tumors. So in the reaction diffusion models, so you what you do is that you smooth your contour over time, and if you combine reaction and diffusion, as we will see later, you can actually end up with some propagation. So by combining reaction and diffusion. So what is interesting is that in both cases, if you properly choose your boundary conditions, you can show that the overall number of tumor cells over time, so this is this left-hand side here, so the integral of C over the volume is the total number of tumor cells. These tumor cells still follow the global law, like we've seen before, you know, the ordinary differential equations. So overall, the volume follows these ordinary differential equations. However, your local model will say how this will spread in space, and this is what is of interest here. So we are using now reaction diffusion equations, and now this is just a short summary of a history of using local growth models. So in 1995, Philippe Trakey was doing a postdoc in the University of Washington at Seattle, and he published the first paper on 2D tumor growth using one slice and then isotropic principle and homogeneous. And so his advisor was James Murray, who was a famous professor at the University of Washington. And so James Murray published this very interesting book called Mathematical Biology. It comes into two volumes, and so I will actually, if you're interested in this topic, I advise you to look into this book, which looks at how to use reaction diffusion equations in order to model some biological phenomena, including tumor growth. So in 1995, Philippe Trakey was doing his postdoc, and in fact, even he decided to quit this topic because he said it requires too much computation, and we will never get three-dimensional information. So in 2002, one of the students of James Murray, Christine Swanson, again at the University of Washington, she started to use the medical images, 3D medical images, in order to simulate the growth of 3D tumors inside the brain. And she was using this 3D simulation with isotropic but non-homogeneous principles. And in 2005, so our group at INRIA in Sophia Antipolis, but also a group at INSERN, we started to introduce non-homogeneous and anisotropic principle for tumor growth in the brain. And this was based on a paper that appeared in 1996, claiming that the diffusion of tumor cells in the brain can be differentiated between white matter and gray matter. So in the white matter, you have this myelin sheath, which is created with brain fibers, and which acts as a highway for migration. So in the tumor growth, the tumor cells, they migrate faster in this white matter than in the gray matter. And so that's why we had this idea of using diffusion tensor imaging, which was fairly new at the time, in order to constrain the anisotropic diffusion of tumor cells in the brain. Okay, now, in the reminder of three slides, I'd like to show you the principle of reaction diffusion equation. It's important that you understand this principle. So I have a 1D phenomena of tumor growth. So I have taken only 4 points for which the initial tumor cell concentration is different from zero. So if I move over time, I am solving actually ordinary differential equation this time. And then you have a tumor concentration that grows from zero to one, not from zero, but 0. Epsilon to one during over time. So just like having this ordinary differential equations. Now, if you perform diffusion, so if you have a tumor cell density, so diffusion acts like convoluting with a Gaussian over time. You know, that's the solution of a heat equation. So diffusion means that you are smoothing your signals. Okay. Now, the reaction diffusion actually acts by combining these two effects. So you have this effect of increasing the value of a tumor cell at the same time as smoothing. And if you combine these two, you've got this phenomena of a wave that propagates in one dimension here. Okay? And so this is how you can simulate the growth of a phenomenon, in this case, of tumor cell density over time by combining this phenomena of reaction, so which increase the value, in this case, to one, and then by smoothing at the same time. Okay? So a better understanding of this equation is that how is the speed? So if I come back here, you can see this front at the end is like moving with a given speed. Okay, so you can show using some asymptotic analysis that the speed is governed by the product of d, which is the diffusion, and rho, which is the amount of proliferation. Okay, so the product d and rho, and you take the square root of this, multiply by two, controls the speed of the front. So if I take these examples here, well, you can see on the right hand side you can draw the speed of the front, and the front is taken as iso value of the tumor cell density. So here it's 0.5. So as I draw, I'm following over time this point, which has always 0.5 tumor cell density, and now I'm plotting on the right-hand side the velocity of this point over time, and you can see that you get these curves where the velocity increases until it reaches some asymptotic speed, and the value that I gave you here, this velocity index, corresponds to the asymptotic speed of the front. Okay. But there is another phenomenon that occurs is that during the reaction diffusion equations, the front reach an asymptotic shape. So this is the different shapes here of a front that is reached in 1D. And this front can be characterized by the invincibility index, which is this time the ratio of D over rho. So by changing the value of D over rho, you change the slope, okay, of the front. So if D is very large, then you have this very widespread front, which means that you have a large invasion of tumors. And if D is small, then you've got this very steep front. So again, this is an example here. So these are three parameters, three set of parameters for my reaction diffusion equations. Well, they have the same speed, the same value of asymptotic speed, but they have different invisibility index. So you can see here that I've got here a steep front, I've got here I would say a softer front, but they, at the end, they propagate at the same speed. So you've got 2 degrees of freedom to characterize your spreading waves. You've got the speed of a wave, but also the shape of a front. And one is governed by the product of two parameters, and the other one of the ratio of these two parameters. And one is called the velocity of a front, the other one is called the invisibility index. And so if you plot these two indexes, you can produce, you can map the, I would say you can characterize your tumor growth by plotting the, I would say in this log-log graph. You can have a velocity in this direction, and you've got in this direction here the invisibility index. So on the x-axis, you use the diffusion, and the row axis, you use the reaction term. And because we use a log-log term, the fact that you have a constant product appear as a straight lines. Okay? So this is a state space, Fisher equations, which is very useful to characterize your the tumor. So for instance, high grade gliomas, so HGG here, they usually occur in these regions, while low grade glioma, they are usually occur in these regions. And so this can be used to help the grading of the tumors. So let me give you some examples of a tumor growth model that we proposed in 2005. So we use this reaction diffusion equations, and where to compute the diffusion tensor here, we use the diffusion tensor imaging. So we considered isotropic growth in the gray matter, but anisotropic growth in white matter, where we scale the DTI information. And there are other methods to compute this tumor diffusion tensor. So we use this DTI information to, again, compute the tensor of diffusion. Okay. Now, we also, so we use this segmentation, DTI. We define some proper boundary conditions, taking into account the ventricles, the fact that the tumor cells do not invade the CSF, you know, the cerebrospinal fluid. And also the false cerebri acts as a natural barrier. And we also added in our model some mechanical principle, because in some cases, you've got some what we call the mass effect. So the tumor grows, but then it pushes the neighboring tissue. And at some point, it compresses the neighboring tissue such that it's actually it alters the function of the brain. So computing this mass effect is of high importance. So this is a movie which was built in 2005 from patient data, from a given patient, and we are simulating the growth of a glioblastoma. You can see the huge extent of the growth, unfortunately, for this patient for 6 months. And you can observe how the tumor grows mainly during in white matter. So in transparency, you can see here the white matter regions and the gray matter regions. Because the tumor grows faster in white matter, you can see that it mainly follows the white matter regions. And if you are careful, you can also observe that this yellow representation of the ventricles is being deformed as the tumor grows nearby. So this is capturing the mass effect of the tumor. Okay. Now, I will not really enter into the details of implementation, but you can use either explicit way of implementing partial differential equations, which have good properties of being easily parallelizable, or you can use semi-implicit ones. Okay, so recently we have introduced a more advanced tumor cell model. I'd like to just to show you some results here. This is ongoing work. Well, we not only consider one type of tumor cells, but three types of tumor cells. We consider proliferating cells, the one that divide themselves by mitosis, that proliferate, but also that can diffuse, that move over space. We consider the quiescent cells. So the quiescent cells are like tumor cells that are suffering from apoptosis, so they lack oxygen. And so before becoming necrotic, they switch their behavior. Instead of trying to proliferate, which requires a lot of energy, they become into a quiescent cells. They become quiet, if you want. They don't proliferate as much as before, but they can become very easily proliferating if there is a new blood supply that occurs. And finally, there is necrotic cells, the cells that die. So this is a model that was developed with our colleagues in Bordeaux, Thierry Collin and Olivier Sceau, when we model the transition between proliferating cells, quiescent cells, and necrotic cells as a function of a vascularization. So this vascularization basically sends signals about the transition between one type of cell to the next. So these are the joint partial differential equations. I will not into the details, but we are also including the vascularization. So we are also in somehow basically simulating the effect of angiogenesis, the fact that if you have got proliferating cells in the nearby, so you've got this term here, that will encourage the creation of new vessels next to proliferating cells due to this VEGF signal. Now, okay, moving to the simulations here. So we are not only here in this case simulating one tumor cell density, but actually three. So the density of quiescent cells, proliferating cells, and necrotic cells. So you can see, and finally, you are also looking at how the vascularization evolves over time. So these are, I would say, non-personalized simulations. And they have some kind of proof of concept, if you want. So you can see that you've got proliferating cells that is developing into a ring, and the necrotic cells develop at the center of this ring, exactly like we have this necrotic core that exists at the center of a tumor. So the cells become necrotic because there is a lack of oxygen due to the proliferating cells that consume a lot of nutrients and oxygen. Okay. And then you've got the quiescent cells, which basically proliferate and diffuse far away from the center of a tumor, and which are acting like isolated tumor cells. So again, this is, you can see that now we have complexified a bit our model, but we can still be able to capture some basic principles of tumor cell growth, which is, at least for high-grade glioma, which is the fact that you've got a necrotic core, you've got these quiescent cells, and this angiogenesis. Okay, now I will enter into the personalization domain. Again, we would like to, we have this tumor growth model, we have this patient data, and we'd like to personalize our models with respect to this data. So, again, to I would say show the objective of model personalization, you've got your tumor growth model, you've got your observations, then you compare the simulated observations with the measured ones. And from this comparison, especially the discrepancy between the growth of a model and the visible boundary in the image, you can fit the parameters, global parameters and local parameters, and then iterate. So this is the, I would say, the main process taking place during the model personalization. You simulate, you compare with the observation, you refine your parameters, and then you iterate like this. Okay, now we will start by personalizing the growth speed. So in this case, you have n images of that is being observed, and then you want to estimate the speed of a front. And in fact, this problem is much simpler than what we have been doing so far. You don't need a reaction diffusion model for this, since what you observe is a front that moves over time, exactly like a level set in image segmentation. And in fact, we are using the same type of approach as the level sets, that we are using, we perform an asymptotic analysis, and then we formulate our problem into a iconal equation. So iconal equations, they describe how the, so basically, in the, they describe the time at which a wave reaches a given point. And so this is formulated as, the unknown is T, which is the time at which the front reaches a given point. So if you are using isotropic iconal equations, you have this formula, you see F gradient of T equal 1. And for anisotropic propagation, the propagation of a tumor growth, you get this anisotropic formulation. And the nice thing with iconal equations is that they can be solved using fast matching, and in this case with anisotropic fast matching. So we have complexified a bit this iconal model by including a dependence on time, because as we have seen, the time of the speed of a front is not constant over time. It starts slowly, it starts to grow until it reaches an asymptotic speed. So we have proposed this formula. Actually, this was also based on prior work. And then we have also included the dependence on curvature. So the front in 3D has a curvature, and the curvature influences the speed of evolution of the front. And this leads to a so-called iconal curvature equations that can be solved either as with a level set or with iterated fast matching method, which is something that we've done actually. So this is a comparison between using the reaction diffusion equations in white and using the traveling time or the iconal model in black. So you can see that you can approach fairly well the tumor growth models using this traveling time formulation. And this has also an interesting property that it leads to much faster computation, up to 1,000 speed-up factor between computing the reaction diffusion and the traveling time solution. So this is an example of a tumor growth model formulated as a traveling time front that evolves over time using this sophisticated iconal model. So on the outside, it looks just like the model that we've seen before. However, this is much simpler to compute with a single front that advances over time. Okay, so in our tumor growth model, we have the unknown corresponds to the white matter diffusion parameters, proliferation rate, and the time of appearance, which is a new parameter that has been introduced with this time-dependent formulation. However, the speed of the growth of a tumor is governed by the product of rho and d. This means that if we only observe the speed, we can only recover the product of the two, and therefore we cannot observe either rho and d, but we can observe only d if we fix rho, and this is actually what we've done. We only estimated, we set the value of rho, and then we estimate the two diffusivity parameters. And this is an example that you see here in these slides, where you can see both two simulations of a tumor growth with two sets of parameters, which are very different. And you can see that they lead to the same visible boundaries. So again, this is showing that you can choose several sets of combination of parameters leading to the same observation. And therefore, you need to solve this by setting one of the parameters. So in this personalization, you've got this time-dependent tumor segmentations. And then what we want to estimate is the speed in the white matter and the gray matter and this time of origin. So for this, we start by simulating forward with a current set of parameters. We simulate forward to have to know the future extent of a tumor. We simulate backward also to know the planned time of the tumor was created. This is the estimation of T0. And then what we do is that we try to optimize the criteria, which is a combination of two things. The first one is the distance between the simulated contour and the observed one. And so we take here the symmetric distance. And then we also add the discrepancy between the simulated initiation of a tumor and this with the observed one. And then we do this optimization. So this optimization is a nonlinear one and cannot be done using gradient descent because we cannot estimate how much the boundary evolves as you change the parameters. So we use a gradient-free algorithm. So you may know, for instance, the simplex mid-simplex method for which is a gradient-free algorithm of optimization. Here we use a method proposed by Powell, which has a strange name. I will not try to pronounce it, but has some nice properties of estimating locally quadratic approximation of your error surface. So when we do this, we can estimate not only the parameters, but also the uncertainty on the parameters. So that's a very nice feature, I think. So for instance, it's maybe hard to read this graph, but so for instance, in this synthetic case, we knew the value of d white and d gray. So this corresponds to this point here. And these are the, I would say, the uncertainty centered onto the estimated parameter. So you can see that the value of d white has been well estimated, but there is a large discrepancy for d gray. And the reason is that d gray corresponds to the low speed of propagation. So when you have a mixture of a high speed and low speed, it's very hard to estimate the low speed parameters because it's hidden by the high speed parameters. So let's move to some real examples here. So both from high grade and low grade at two different times. So we start by high-grade glioma. So these are the status of a high-grade glioma at day 21. So we use these two extents of a tumor to learn the parameters, and this was basically the most likely parameter that was found. And then from that, we can predict in the future. So once you have learned the parameters, you can say, now, okay, what happens if I move to day 67? So I can move forward my the tumor growth. It's exactly what we've done here. Okay. So we predict the future extent of a tumor, and then we can compare with the actual one. And this is what has been done here, when we can compare the white contour with the red contour. So there is some discrepancy, but in fact, here we are assuming that the speed of the growth will be constant. And this probably is not true because of several phenomena, including the effect of therapy, for instance, radiotherapy or chemotherapy. So this is a similar example for low-grade glioma, where we again learn the set of parameters from two time points and we do some predictions. And these are examples here of the parameters that has been estimated from this set. So now I'm going to move to the invisibility index. So how to personalize the invisibility index? So remember that we make the hypothesis that the T1 abnormality corresponds to a high threshold of tumor cell density, while the T2 abnormality corresponds to a low threshold of tumor cell density. So if we know these two contours, then we can make some basic rule that correlates the invisibility index, which corresponds to this extent, the slope here, with these two radii. Okay? And this was done by Christine Sanson in her group to estimate these parameters. And what we have worked in something different is that if we know the invisibility index, if we know a contour, we can extrapolate the tumor cell density from the invisible part. So let me show you an example here. So in the high-grade glioma, given the visible boundary, which is shown in orange here, we can extrapolate the tumor cell density outside this visible boundary. And for that, we again use this anisotropic formulation of reaction diffusion in order to estimate the profile, if you want, of a tumor cell density next to this visible contour. And if we change the value of D and rho, the invisibility index, we will get different spread of the iso value. So I'd like to finish this part here on stating that there are some strong limitations to these models. This is still preliminary. And the first one is to cope with the fact that it's difficult to have a patient DTI. And in clinical settings, usually you have to limit the amount of time the patient spends into an MR machine. And therefore, we found some issues here with having DT MRI images of patients. The second issue is that we assume in our models that the DT MRI is undisturbed by the tumor growth. And we know it's wrong. The tumor basically destroys the extracellular matrix. And therefore perturbs strongly the diffusion tensor. A third point is that we need to take into account the uncertainty in the tumor delineation. We have seen that it's extremely hard to segment a tumor, and therefore we need to propose some uncertainty on the estimation of the parameters. So I've shown some example of that, but I think we need to go further, just like we have for the weather forecast, where we can actually propose some confidence measurements with respect to this. Our model currently can only grow, it cannot shrink. This is true for the asymptotic model. Asymptotic model can only grow, and in fact, a tumor can shrink due to the effect of therapy. And finally, we should also better take into account the mass effect. So there are still a lot of things to improve, but I think these are some promising research being done on this. So I'd like to conclude by giving you some hints about, although those models are far from perfect, they are still suffer some limitations, but they can still be used for trying to answer some clinical problems. And you have to keep in mind the fact that clinicians right now are still using this 1D diameter to make decisions about the therapy. So even the models that we propose are far from perfect. They're still, I think, one step beyond the state of the art for understanding the growth of tumors. So this improvement of clinical practice is both for diagnosis, surgery, and radiotherapy. So for diagnosis, we have performed some recent study where we have compared the speed actually estimated by the model. So in fact, the model estimates the white matter speed and the gray matter speed, but we take the average of the two. So we can compare the speed proposed by the model here with the speed estimated by clinicians either in 1D, 2D, or 3D. So you can see that the proportion of speed is right in the middle, if you want, of these different estimations. So we don't have ground truth again. There is not such thing as a perfect measurement of speed. But this is already reassuring that we have not outliers. So a second thing is that we can propose this type of maps. We can map a tumor for a given patient onto this, as I said, Fisher state space. And this is interesting to actually grade. We could propose some novel grading of tumors based on those two indices. And finally, we have looked at the prediction of our model. So by predicting the time to progression. So time to progression is the time at which the tumor grows by more than 20%. So we have shown that our, the prediction based on our model gives a better results than the prediction based on 1D models. So this time to progression is important because you need to for a patient to plan for maybe when he will have to undergo surgery, and this allows him for also to give a better way of organizing his life before maybe planning the future therapy. So we were reassuring that our models was able to have a better prediction of time to progression, although again it suffers from limitations. So this, I think, is an important findings for diagnosis. Another work we've done also recently was to take into account the brain anatomical barriers. So in fact, when the tumor occurs next to sulci and gyri in the brain, it's important that we take into account the fact that the geodesic distance is very different from the Euclidean distance. So for instance, in this area here, if you have got a tumor occurring at this location, or let me use a pointer maybe. Okay, so if you have a tumor occurring at these regions here, to reach this point, it will have to go this way and this way. Okay. While if you make a mistake into your mask, it can very quickly reach this area. And this area may be an area for important functional brain, so some functional areas. So it's very important that you take careful care of these anatomical barriers. And so we had a student working with Emmanuel Mandonnet, who is a neurosurgeon in Paris, who has modified this MNIT template to really enforce the anatomical barrier to have a better prediction of a spread of a tumor. And also we work with Emmanuel on the recurrence after surgery. So this is a typical timeline for patients being treated for brain tumors. You have a diagnosis of imaging. After some point, after some time here, like 45 days, they decide to go for surgery. And so they remove this part as much as they can. So these are the images. So first you can see lots of artifacts. This is due to the edema. And then after some days, the edema resides, and then you can see the areas, okay. And unfortunately, at some point, you can see the recurrence of a tumor that grows again in these regions here, okay. So the question that was asked by the neurosurgeon is that, can we predict the time, the location of a recurrence of a tumor? So, and the extent of infiltration. Again, you've got this, the big idea here. You've got this tumor that is present. This is visible in the MR, but there's also an invisible part that you cannot see in MR. So you do some resection. So obviously, you leave some parts which is invisible in the image because you cannot resect as much as you can. Because also this part is invisible. And then this invisible part will start to regrow again. And then this will be the location of the recurrence. So the question of the, again, the neurosurgeon was, can we predict the location of this recurrence and at which time? And in fact, I cannot say that we provided solid answers to him. And one reason is that the resection of a tumor leads to extremely large deformations. So just to give you an example in this case, this was the extent of a tumor before surgery. And this is the extent of a tumor after surgery. So you can see that the deformation from this to this is extremely complex and cannot be really taken care with the average restoration algorithm. So it's very hard to propagate information from preoperative to postoperative surgery. But in one case, we had very limited deformations. And we were able to at least some propose some recurrence, which is fairly in good agreement with actual ones. So the idea is the following. You have a tumor that is being segmented before surgery. And then you make this extrapolation of the invisible boundary. So you extrapolate, if you want, the tumor cell density beyond the visible borders. So this is what you do here. And then you simulate the resection, and then you grow again based on the what is left of the tumor cells. And then you predict where the tumor cell density will be beyond a given threshold. And in this case, we were able to predict the recurrence was located at the right point. So, but I would say that this is an extremely difficult problem, and not only due to the large deformations, but also the understanding of the phenomena occurring in MR imaging. Sorry, I will skip that. So finally, and the last application is for radiotherapy. And you know that radiotherapy is the planning of radiotherapy is based on images and the segmentation of tumor cells. And so we have been collaborating with MGH in Boston for this topic, and also with Centre Antoine Lacassagne in Nice. And the classical approach is the following. So you've got the visible tumor in flare, so you got this yellowish area. And then for the tumor dose, you take a margin of 2 centimeters around this area. So this is what you get here in white. And of course, you remove the parts here, which is on CSF. And then you plan for this constant margin. Okay. Now, the idea is that we want to replace this constant margin by something which is smarter. Because we know the tumor doesn't grow isotropically, but anisotropically, we can basically guess the extent of a tumor outside the visible boundary. So you get this new contours visible here. And therefore, now we want to adapt the dose by taking into account not only this white contour, but this new contour here. And this means that there will be, I think what we claim, we think, is that there will be tissue that were healthy, that were previously targeted. This is the yellowish color here. And there are, in the previous classical plan, there was also tumor cells that were not targeted. And so we think that adapting the radiotherapy plan by using the anisotropic boundary would lead to better irradiation and also saving some of the healthy tumor cells. So again, this goes into this idea of, in this case, for instance, given these visible tumors, predict that the invaded area in the image is not only this bulky area, but it's all this area. And then we want to, this is the tumor cell density, we want to adapt the radiotherapy plan to these situations. Okay, in yellow here, you get the regular standard target volume plan in radiotherapy. So, in fact, planning the dose is also performed by optimizing a problem. So you take into account the fact that the higher the dose, the lower is the probability of survival of tumor cells. So you've got this so-called linear quadratic model that you have here, which is exactly like this. It says that the higher the dose, the lower the probability of survival. And then it leads to an optimization problem. So you want to optimize the dose such that you minimize the number of surviving tumor cells. But you have to take into account the fact that the dose cannot be greater than some threshold. And in this case, it's 60 gray. It could be a bit higher depending on the radiotherapist. But so you have to solve this optimization problem. And in this case, we use the tumor cell density that is being estimated in the tumor model. So this was a joint work with Jan Kolbach at MGH. And we propose actually to adapt the radiotherapy margin. So in the left-hand side, you've got the classical dosimetry using the standard margin, which is shown here. And on the right and the middle, you see the adapted, optimized dosimetry, taking into account the anisotropic diffusion of tumor growth. And this was computed such that the amount of dose is the same in both cases. And So in this case, we are able to propose, again, a novel way of planning radiotherapy based on this tumor cell model. And then we can also make different hypotheses about the invisibility index. If we assume that there is a lot of diffusion in the, a lot of migration of tumor cells in the brain, like this, so this leads to a high invisibility index, then your dose, the plan of dose could be different than if you assume that you have a low migration of cells, which will be like steeper distribution of tumor cells. So you can make different hypotheses and therefore different planning. So we would like to pursue this idea further in the future in order to make a new advance in the therapy planning. So now I'd like to conclude. I'll just recall some of the main challenges that we were faced by developing these tumor growth models. So I think one of the main challenges that remains is the understanding of the imaging of brain tumors. I've already said that the hypothesis that T2 abnormality and T1 abnormality corresponds to iso value of tumor cell density is probably not correct. It's maybe related to edema, and so we need to have a better understanding also maybe to use different image modalities. And for instance, you could use MR spectroscopy. In MR spectroscopy, I teach voxels instead of measuring structure of protons. We are measuring the amount of metabolite which is present in this amount of voxels. And so some of these metabolites are characteristics to the tumors. So we think that we could use these new image modalities to better understand the presence of tumor cells in the brain. There's also basically different problems with that, but and also currently we are trying to understand the difference between the edema. What is edema, in fact? So some of the edema is purely made of water. This is called vasogenic edema. And some parts of the edema include some isolated tumor cells. And so it's very important when you do your planning, radiotherapy or surgery, that you differentiate between the two. So we are also working on that with MGH. And in terms of modeling, I've already shown you some work in progress with these multiple compartments models. So I think this is interesting, but so far we cannot personalize it. And because it's one level of complexity greater than the previous one. And we'd like also to use more imaging, because if you use PET or perfusion imaging, we can maybe add new observations that could be useful for this type of complex models. There is also the issue of DT-MRI, which I mentioned, and finally also the fact that we'd like to apply these techniques to a larger cohort of patients. And so far, the number of patients that we have processed is on the order of 20, and this is, of course, not enough, but this requires a lot of processing and some very rich data, so we would like to move into a larger cohort of patients. So finally, I'd like to conclude by summarizing some take-home messages from my lecture. The first one the first part of my lecture was about model personalization. So I hope to have, discussed maybe convince you that the importance of model personalization for better understanding medical images. I have also went through this difference between data assimilation and data regularization. For biophysical models, we are more interested into data assimilation, which is consistent of optimizing the parameters. I think also the notion of parameter observability is an important one, and I have shown in the tumor growth models that we cannot estimate all the parameters, and sometimes only the ratio of parameters, sometimes the product of parameters. Also, the fact that we consider a model as a tool, and we know that a model is wrong, but we can still find a large section of applications that can be of clinical use. And finally, so I have introduced the concept of glioma growth models, starting from the very basic global growth models, then going to the local ones using these reaction diffusion equations, and finally these multiple compartments. I've shown some preliminary results on the personalization of those models, and found some clinical application, especially for radiotherapy. So this concludes my talks, and I thank you a lot.